IVM.
Hi, everybody. Just wanted to ask everyone for a quick favor. We're running a brand survey right now and would really appreciate it if you could let us know what you think about the advertising on IVM. Go to ivmpodcast.com/survey and do let us know. As part of this, we'll be selecting 10 random participants and sending them some IVM swag. So do fill out those surveys.
Understanding internet culture is crucial for the brands of today to not just market themselves, but to seamlessly and authentically embed themselves into today's popular culture. And this authentic embed is being driven by marketers and agencies who have a deep understanding of internet culture and its nuances by virtue of being creators themselves. One such agency is One Hand Clap, and today I have their founder and CEO Akash Shah on Advertising Is Dead, drilling into all of this and so much more. I'm Varun Dugirala, and this is Advertising Is Dead. Right back with Akash.
$100, that's all it takes to begin your journey with Bitcoin and Ethereum. No, really. With CoinSwitch, you can start investing in over 100 cryptocurrencies with just 100 rupees. On top of that, there are zero charges for deposits and withdrawals, so you can trade, buy, sell, however and whenever you want. All of this, plus their extremely intuitive interface, makes CoinSwitch the perfect app for beginners in the crypto space. But don't take my word for it. Just download CoinSwitch for free and try it out for yourself. If you'd like more information on cryptocurrencies, tune into A Show About Crypto with me, Rohan Joshi, my new adventure on IVM Podcasts. CoinSwitch, kuch to badlega.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead with Akash. Okay, Akash, I'm going to start this off. I know you were starting to do this before we hit record, but I thought I'll keep it for after we hit record is because this recording has been so long coming. It is like, it feels like, this is pre-pandemic. Like pre-pandemic is when you and I first spoke about doing this episode. And it has consistently been this loop where for the most bizarre reasons, we have not recorded so far. So firstly, apologies from my end for that front. But and also finally, welcome to the show.
Apologies from my end, Varun. When for Varun first reached out, I was pretty excited. Okay, let's go. Let's do this. And what it turned out to be was I ended up canceling it at the last moment. And the primary reason for that was me overthinking and going into a spiral of, have I done enough to be on this? Should I just wait it out for another 1.5 years? So 1.5 years later now, like now we are here doing this.
Yeah, and finally doing it. And so much to talk about. But you know, I always enjoyed how you think about marketing, because I always enjoy when someone looks at it from doesn't use the word marketing. You talk about web culture, you talk about, I hate to just say meme marketing, but I think web culture is a stronger word there, because what you and the entire company does is actually you focus on web culture and how to kind of connect brands to that. I think that's the best way I can explain it. And there's some really cool work and really exciting work that you guys have done in the recent past on that front. But I wanted to first start off by asking you, because I do know a little bit about your origin story. How does someone who's trying to be a chartered accountant end up becoming someone pushing web culture?
I think partly how it began is a bizarre story. In fact, how the agency also began is a very bizarre story. Mm. Almost feels like you were never meant to do this. It just kind of kept happening. But to start off with, like how from CA, I was pretty bad at it, like to begin with, like just very bad at it, continuously failing one attempt after the other. What that gave me was time in between. So every time I would fail an attempt, then I would again have a 6-month prep time to appear for the next attempt. And out of those 6 months, I would just spend 4 to 5 months just wandering around on the internet, trying to create things, etc., etc. So I think that is where it began. Like during my, like when I failed my second attempt, I started this page called Pokemons of New York. At the time, Pokemon Go was catching heat, and like we were seeing the reemergence of the entire Pokemon fan base trying to like live the nostalgic old days because of the app that went viral, Pokemon Go. So I started doing that around that time, which I think that was the first moment of like what virality feels like. That was one of the first few times, because I remember like the media outlets covering it. Then an interview on Aaj Tak happened and everything else happened. I think that was when this started happening. When I failed my third attempt of CA, around that time I started this page called what humans of Bombay, not humans of Bombay, Bombay High Court.
Yeah.
I cannot get over what happened with that page. I mean, I'm spoiler alert, but I mean, that's something you put in your bio, like.
Yeah, it's a badge of honor. I'll just carry it with me.
Yeah. Sorry.
So that happened. Yeah, and that happened. That is, I think, essentially when I realized, because I started getting in touch with people from.
Okay, just to explain because I cut you off while you're telling that story. You made a page called Bombay High Court and the Bombay High Court made you take that page down.
Yeah.
That's what...
Which is interesting because the page was pretty popular within like the corridors of Bombay High Court as well. Mm. Like the lawyers enjoyed it. The judges enjoyed it. I got messages from perhaps like all sides, like all kinds of people working at Bombay High Court that they enjoy the page. Someone who is not a part of Bombay High Court, like someone just outside of this entire circuit, who couldn't take this joke, and that is why the Suo Motu petition was filed to take the page down.
I realize that's how most of these things happen. It's always one random person who is not necessarily connected. Because I remember even when I used to work in television, there would be some... I remember there was a professor in Bandra who would randomly keep watching television all the time and filing these complaints on something that was said on some... I think it was MTV and Channel V at that time. I'm like... There aren't enough people watching those channels anyway. You have the time to do that. So there is always, I always found that there are always these people who will do that. And it's not necessarily the regular ones.
Yeah, I think whatever starts catching heat, like whatever starts becoming popular, it's easy to piggyback on the clout of it to perhaps further your, whatever your agenda is.
Yeah.
I think that is what usually keeps on happening. And we see it from time and again, like over the years, like we've just seen it. I have just seen it happening it repeatedly again and again and again and again.
And then post that, how did, and from there, how did AIB happen? And then from there, how did One Hand Clap happen?
So using like with Bombay High Court, I think Bombay High Court was one of those instant hits. Within a month or two, I realized, okay, this is going somewhere with some close to 50,000 likes. In 4 months time, again, it had 3 lakh likes. And page was catching proper viral attention, like in fact in national media as well, all the newspapers, etc. So like I knew like it's bigger than like what it seems like, because then other pages would crop up saying like Delhi High Court, etc., etc. Like so it became this huge momentum. What led to that was YouTubers, other advertising agencies, and all this entire cluster of universe which I was never introduced to just got introduced to me in a span of like 15 days. Like, this is what's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember one of the first messages, Bhuvan Bhan dropped a message ki in Agarwal of Alma Meto. He dropped me a message, ki, let's write a script together. And like bunch of different kinds of work just started coming my way. And that's, I think that is when the decision was made, okay, like we can just keep CA at bay, like not focus on CA now. Yeah. There's just bunch of work coming my way. Let's see like what suits the... So I just started taking up work. Like I wrote a parody song with Varun Agarwal. I started writing. Like I took up a writing gig with Bhuvan Bam. Tanmay messaged. I took up, and then AIB job happened. Tanmay also messaged out of the blue saying like, just come. We'll figure a rollout for you at AIB. Why don't you just come? And the copy test that came my way, which was I think one of the hardest copy tests to crack, because there was just so much to write and so much to prove. I did not end up writing that copy test. A month later, Tanmay said, just come, forget the copy test, just come and let's do an interview. Next day I go, we talk about things. I tell him some bizarre plans that I had with Bombay High Court, which in retrospect make no sense at all. he just found it very interesting and he said, just come join AIB, we'll do something together.
Yeah.
So I just joined in the capacity of like someone who will just figure out what to do at AIB. He said, you can maybe write for us, maybe you can handle our social media, etc. Once AIB happened, I immediately just took up the social media mandates for it, and me and Tanmay started building a team from scratch on how to run social.
And from there, actually, when you launched One Hand Clap as well, a large part of that team was the founding team of One Hand Clap, and that's where this, because you guys had done so much in just working around, I mean, that's what you guys did, that you really figured a way to get a pulse on web culture, and you were translating that across all your accounts. And I think this is a seamless way. So, okay, we can do this for brands because we have been doing this as part of AIB, and I'm guessing that's how that happened. But once you move to that, I call it an agency mindset. Once you move to an agency mindset, there are many hurdles and many hoops in your own head in some time, in some cases, not even just like dealing with brands that come up. So how did that transition kind of happen, and how did you kind of deal with that, but also like how did the team deal with it?
So I think the beginning of it was, so me and Tanmay would visit Bangalore regularly. And the idea was to like start taking up some marketing mandates in upcoming startups. So we would do meetings, say with Zomato. We met with folks at Cred. We met a bunch of other startups. We also met PUBG India, who just had begun operations like in a physical capacity in India. So we met these folks. We were trying to mostly understand problems, so like how we can help and where do we fit in. And like they also had various problems on like, on product front. Like at first, I think we started tackling, okay, what can we do on product front? If there is a way to gamify any of these products, we started working on those problems. I think eventually what it led to was me finding my niche in saying that, oh, like I get social so well, let me just focus on social, everything else aside. Maybe product and all of that, like all of that is a separate battle to fight. And there's, it just requires a lot more like understanding on the engineering front to be able to sit with those folks who will also understand and take feedback from you, because why would they take feedback from us? So I think that is what happened. Like I just found my niche with social again. Then again, me with Masi, Nikhil, Manoj, Gladwin, Aditya, and then there's Pankti who joined us like 15 days later. The six of us, we just catapulted this into becoming One Hand Clap on launching. And like after like on launch, like we realized there's just a lot of roles to be filled now. Like we are just starting to begin this. There's a bunch of things that we have no idea about, and the expectations from clients are going to be insane, like the kind of things that they expect.
Because suddenly the words like servicing and words like account management, and then you get into like, I think there's so many parts of the agency business which you don't realize are there, and they're there. I mean, I don't think all of them are there for the reason that they actually are required to be there. I feel a lot of them are also handovers from legacy of sorts. But I also over time realized that a lot of them have very specific roles. And when you're doing pure play creative, you don't necessarily realize that. So would have been a tricky one to kind of add in there.
Yeah, I think when you begin it, you realize like what like me and the team collectively felt was, why are these roles important? Why can't just, I think just 2.5 years later, you realize, oh, like this is why. And there's just so much more to it. I think when you begin here, you kind of come in with a revolutionary mindset that, oh, I'll be here and I'll change the system. And I think over time you realize that the age-old wisdom, like the ones who are also in it for such a long time, there are lots of various reasons why so many roles are being filled and so many different kinds of jobs are there. Like the open positions are there for these roles. It's not just about creating, but also there's data, there's client servicing, there's this all a lot takes for idea to reach where it's due, like, and to become. Just having an idea is not everything.
So if I had to ask, and I'm going to slight detour over here, is that around the time when you started working on AIB Social, I think at that time there were still all these individuals dealing with the web culture, you guys kind of figured a funnel to put it all together. Now when you see it, everybody is that connect with culture, the word content obviously is I think blatantly misused in every single category. So I don't even use the word content anymore. I'm like, I don't see the point. But I think that there is something about culture, and especially if you look at the last 1.5 years of us literally existing only online and not in physical form. How have you seen that evolve? And how are you seeing how you create for that audience now, but also how even the audience has kind of evolved?
Yeah, I think given the last 10 years that you mean, because what I genuinely feel is we have only seen people creating at such a scale only in the last 10 years, and more so in just the last 5 years. The tools did not exist for masses before that. And to given whenever a new form of, say, a discovery happens that we can do this, like I was reading Sapiens the other day, like how like fire has existed for like close to 300,000 years.
Yeah.
And like we have managed to, like when it began, like maybe when we discovered it, and to reach its final stage of like how we use fire safely. So, and there's still events of disasters because of it. So like it's taken like 300,000 years, and we are still not able to control it in like and use it for how we would like it to be. Coming to like after fire would be, I think language has existed for 1.5 lakh years, and we still struggle with languages. Like, and we still struggle. Like Google Translate still doesn't like make sure like the entire human species can communicate each other with each other like effectively.
That's so true.
And maybe we'll still not. Now coming to math. Math has existed for 30,000 years. 30,000 years and we still struggle with data and stuff, analytics. We still struggle so much with it.
Math like, also is a genuine problem for some of us like me who cannot like for the life of them understand why we have to. Like I'm like calculator here now. Like, why do I need? And I did engineering. So I'm like, I'm total like, but yeah, I totally get what you mean. But I think the math part is, everything else is still like common knowledge. I'm like, math, do I really have to do it? Is half the time my question. Sorry, I came in between.
Yeah. So it's still absolute chaos when it comes to all these three things. Internet, on the other hand, just 40 years.
Mm.
We are in the middle of chaos, like,
yeah.
And all sorts of chaos. And to top it off, like content creation, only 10 years, like just 10 years, like at this scale.
Mm.
And the scale only rapidly increases. Like we are like heading towards a time where everyone essentially can create content, art, films, etc. Like whatever we call it. Like
yeah.
Now we have all the devices and tools in place. Like anyone can create it from scratch.
Mm.
And that's just been the last 5 years. It's going to be absolute chaos. I think all of us collectively are still figuring it out on what to do with this level of information, the level of like amount of tools available at our hands and all the ways it can like reach the audiences. So it's I just feel it like we are in an absolute chaos of ecosystem, which is also so good to be a part of because there's so much is happening.
Yeah, sometimes chaos is good, right? I think the chaos of the internet, I feel that's also the beauty of it. The more you organize the internet, the less fun it seems, and the less I know that it needs some organization, but I think that there's a certain level of chaos that it actually makes creating within it a lot more fun as well.
Yeah. I think that though, I think a lot of limits already like are placed by the, I think because of the geographical limits, like that is that the government imposes, that the social media, the giants impose, and I think a lot of limitations already kick in when you're creating. And then I think within that, other limitations kick in when certain brands don't want this, certain brands don't. I think just it limits, I think also like that's essentially then now you're not creating for yourself then basically, but mostly trying to create such that it reaches the audiences, and to make it reach the audiences, there's just a lot of things that you have to please and keep in mind. So I don't know if it's fun or not. I think it's subjective.
So in the middle of all of this chaos, how do you get a brand to understand how they could kind of be effective in the middle of this chaos? Because again, internet culture, like you rightly said, is so varied that sometimes it's tough for someone to understand what happened 6 months ago. But things change every day in terms of what people use, how they use it, how they even consume content, how they create content. So how do you work with the brand on that? Because what you guys have at Pulse on is something that is truly like where the consumer today is engaged. But how do you make sure you can translate that for a brand?
I think the playbook here that I usually play by is just give them repeated taste of success with your judgments. So you provide them a judgment, this will work, and it works. Then you do it again, and then you do it again. And then when you're doing it for the fourth or fifth time, they'll trust you, then they'll go blind on you. Okay, like they get it, and he or she gets it. Like, let's just run with it. It's a painful process of navigating expectations with the brand manager and the client and the brand itself and the guidelines that the brand provides. I think it's a painful task that one undertakes and navigates through these intricacies. And also it's a very necessary, like nobody is going to trust you just based on your word. Nobody is going to trust you based on your words. I think you are going to have to repeatedly prove so that this works and why you are the best person to do it.
You know, when you say that, I also find it interesting because I know for a fact that whenever I speak to brands, and I understand the struggle on the brand side, a lot of them till like, if you look at like, I love the fact that you spoke about just the number of years the internet has been a core thing of what we do, right? In the last 5 years, for most brands, they've gone from a few TVCs every year, having maybe a social media page and some posts, to now saying this is where everything is. This is how you sell. This is how people buy. This is how you connect with culture. This is how you understand consumers. This is how you look at data. You're hearing terms like tech stack thrown around. Suddenly, the number of things that you have to do has just blown up, right? As a marketer, if you're on the other side. And for a lot of them, also the systems, obviously companies' systems don't evolve that quickly. The larger you get, the slower it becomes. And anybody, like I have seen our system over the years slow down as we've gotten larger. So I don't even blame like large companies. I'm like, I'm still like comparatively much smaller, but I know how that entire food chain slows down. So they also find it tough to adapt because the systems haven't adapted to this. And then that goes everywhere. So this constant struggle of, okay, we need to be agile, but yet we need to be on the pulse of things is a struggle. I'm very happy at some points that I don't necessarily have to deal with. I know that the brand managers deal with that. But I like the trust point that you maintain, is that if you can actually build trust, then there is a level of agility you can build into this whole thing. And there's a level of agility in terms of work that can happen. Would you say that's one of the reasons why the team still has that pulse on this, and that your team still functions the way you do, because you've been able to over time build that trust and focus on this aspect, and not just, okay, let's suddenly become an agency in the standard sense, or like, you know, just load up from day one. Do you think that's one of the reasons why you guys have worked out the way you have?
Yeah, I think that is the only reason we have worked out the way we have. Coming to like, because I think the moment, I think the last time when we were to do this advertising is that we were at, say, 11 people team, catering to one brand, like various places, but like within one brand, we're only catering to one brand. Like now there's team of 35 people catering to five different brands. I've now started realizing, oh, this is where like the problem lies with respect to large organizations. Your bandwidth is limited. Team's bandwidth is limited. So essentially the level of trust that you would have with, say, one brand, you are now dividing, like my time gets divided between five different brands. So how do you play now? And that essentially brings you to who else in the organization now has that level of trust and basically can, their brand can rely on. I think that's a tough battle. I think some folks play it very beautifully in that sense, in transfer of trust. And also from the brand side of things, like the brand managers keep changing, but like the transfer of trust stays. I think that is when I think the name of, which is why the organization is the organization, which is why Glitch comes into play. Because Varun Dugrela wouldn't have the time, all the time in the world, but like now the transfer of trust is a glitch. I think with me, like the transfer of trust is one hand clap. So I think that is when the name of the organization would come into play, and to live up to it, I think, is a collective task of the entire workforce.
That would have also kind of like, how have you evolved as a leader? I think that you would have had to go through many of these. I wouldn't even say changes. I would just say that you also had to. Some pieces are evolved. Some people you say, okay. Some pieces you say, okay, I can't do that anymore. But this is how I can retain part of that. How have you kind of evolved as a leader during this period?
I think when you begin as a leader, you begin with the mindset that you will do everything, each and everything that comes your way. Not because you are necessarily good at it, but because it's your job to do it. I think now, 2.5 years later, like what I feel is you don't know everything. The best ones who get it, the experts at things, they should be doing it. And that is the reason why you get the best talent to be with you. You hire the best talent from the industry and they'll take care of this because you have done your part. Like you have killed it at some point, and then that is why you have built the system. But now to sustain the system, that's another ballgame altogether, which requires you all the expertise that you can gather. I think that is what has changed. I don't do everything. I don't get into everything, the intricacies and the micromanagements of things. What I've also done is I've just started to pull myself out of the managerial processes and more towards the creative processes, which I think I lost the knack of in the last 2 years. So that is what I'm doing now.
You make an interesting point, right? Is that most times we start doing what we're doing because we enjoy a certain aspect, and in that aspect, for instance, creative. And you spend years, when you build a business, you tend to focus on everything else that you actually didn't want to do. When you mentioned this fact that I don't have time to focus, for years I couldn't focus on anything creative or content related because I was looking after operations and finance, right? Again, I hate numbers and I had to, but I did that. And I feel that's interesting that, you know, if the sooner the realization comes in, this is where I can give real value. There are many people who enjoy doing that other part. Let me just find those people. Yeah. And I feel that decision comes so late. You made that decision quite early. I think people come to that decision much later in their cycle, which is actually, I think that's a good thing that you've said, okay, once I need to focus on creative. That's why I'm in this. I'm not in this for doing ops, unless you are.
Yeah. I think the realization happened with me was when I started seeing, oh, like I'm struggling with this now. Like now numbers are getting out of hand, like the contracts and this, like there's just so much.
Yeah.
With initially with one client, I think it was slightly still easier to do. Now with so much happening and so many things happening all at once, it just bounces off my head. And that is, I think, when I realize, oh, it's a lot. Like this, yeah. This is too much. And while my heart is still solving a campaign or a creative problem, I'm still stuck here, and I just want to get rid of this and go there. So I think that is when the realization came, how do I just get rid of this entirely?
A few more things to talk about. Actually, not just a few, a lot more things to talk about. But before we do that, we need to get into a small break, and we'll be right back after that.
Do check out our new show, Tech Life at Intuit, hosted by Shiladitya Mukhopadhyay. Shiladitya talked to Anshuman Kumar, the director of global brand, and Devanshi Srivastav, software engineer at Intuit India. They talk about Intuit's employee-powered approach, which has won them many accolades and tons more. Here's what they say about what someone joining a new workplace like Intuit should consider before joining.
We want people to come to Intuit, join us, believe in what our mission is, and be able to achieve that by doing the best work of their life and also bringing their whole self to work. I think these have become so profound and so important today that I would say anyone who is looking at joining any company, not just Intuit, should definitely look at what's the mission of that company and how do I connect with that mission or the purpose that the company has and what can I do to amplify it even further.
Catch new episodes of Tech Life at Intuit every Wednesday on the IBM Podcast app, website, or wherever else you get your podcasts from.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead with Akash. Do you also see, just in terms of how you deal with a brand change as well, in terms of just like when you're talking to them about this, over time, as they have gotten more of a pulse of what they will have to do, have you seen the fact that it's almost a bouncing board system rather than, okay, you give me something, I'll give you feedback, you'll go back and forth, but rather than that, it's almost like you're working as one unit to kind of create a bunch of stuff. Have you seen that grow a lot more?
Oh, yeah. Very, very beautifully, in fact, because I think at first, I think I'm again just going back to like then and now situation, but back then you would go with an idea and you would feel that this is the best idea ever. This is art. This is what should happen and nothing else should change about this. With time, you realize like there's just so much more to it. The brand gives you some data points to work with. The brand gives you the briefs to work with. I think it's a lot more collaborative in that nature because you realize you understand where the brand is coming from, although they might not have the creative prowess to essentially make their point. But I get it, like what they're trying to do. Now I get it. Okay, this is what you're trying to do. Maybe you just don't have the right words to maybe convey it. But I get it, what you're trying to do. And I realize also, like, why agencies have a problem with brands. I realize that. It's just the communication barrier. Like, what they want, it's non-effective way of communicating that because, again, brand wouldn't have any creative, creative experience.
You'll have deeper understanding in that sense.
Elaborate on their ideas. I think that is where the problem lies and which is why the disconnect also comes into play between brands and agencies. And they just ended up, like, most brands and agencies just start hating each other after a point. I think that is what happens.
My consistent line to friends, to people in the office is always like, your clients are your friends. Sometimes they're angry friends. Sometimes they're friends who don't understand. Sometimes they're friends you are angry with. but they're still your friends. I think that's the only way you can look at it.
Yeah. So now I get it. And I'm able to solve problems much faster, much effectively, without creativity taking any hits for it. Like now I get it. And so when I enter any of the Zoom calls to explain or pitch an idea or to maybe hear a brief out. From that point onwards to the final execution, that time has just reduced which would otherwise take a lot of time. That time is compressed and I think that just saves a lot of time for everyone.
I know that you all are one gang who are obsessed with the movie Welcome. And I know that's the last time. I remember we were on stage, you and I, and we spoke about Indian meme. Anybody who was creating memes in the Indian web culture space has always, their fallback has been Welcome. Like how I would say my generation, our fallback was Sholay. Because we would go to that. So, and in hindsight, also like really terrible because whenever you don't have a joke, make a joke about a guy who has no arms. Was used to be our fallback. So I've literally shot skits where Thakur has played many roles. Thakur has been a waiter. But how is Thakur going to be a waiter and all those things and stuff. So Sholay was our fallback. Sholay was our fallback for every single pop culture reference we could find. If we didn't have a pop culture reference, still it got boring and people didn't know what Sholay was. But for you guys, it's been welcome, I know for a fact. And I remember seeing this piece where, I think with Pooja Dhingra, you guys did this whole, with the macaroon which had the famous Majnubhai painting on it. And I was like, that's literally translating like web culture onto this. Like it's in physical form now. And how has it been kind of explaining some of these things? Like how will this make sense to, I know Pooja would have gotten it, hopefully. And I know she will because she would have seen enough of that. But how do you translate some of the, how do you explain that to a brand? Like this will work for you for X and Y reason.
Oh, to explain it to a brand, you cannot explain it in its full detail until you execute it. Mm. So then you just ask them to run, like try and run with it once. Maybe sometimes at first you won't go and tell them, let's do an ad film about, let's create a very funny ad film.
Yeah.
Because we have welcome as a title. So maybe we can do something around it. You don't go with that. But maybe I think you do a meme at first. You show the results. You see, benchmark it against all the other things that you've done. Mm. This is working. Mm. You back it with, you just go with data. There's no other way to go about it. But you start small. Then you do something else. Then you engage with the talent of Balcom. Mm. There's more and more data that you gather.
Yeah.
And then that is, I think, the final ultimate would be to reach where you would want to reach with it. Maybe you would want to reach with it. We want to just use this as a consistent theme across the year, or maybe something like that. That is, I think, when you pitch the larger picture of it. At first, you just start small with one, two pieces somewhere around here and there. With maybe if it's a whole campaign, maybe just one piece would be of this, and you would see and benchmark it against the rest of the campaign and say, "Oh, this performs really well against all the other pieces." I think that is what I think. And now I've just learned to just deal with things with like basically with data in like various ways and just show it to them.
Yeah, that's actually very interesting, right? Because I feel that most times if you talk to agency creatives, I know it's improved a lot in recent times. A lot of them either struggle with data because they're like, okay, man, data is not my job. My job is to come for the creative. I know that's been the traditional advertising way to think. And over time, people have learned it. But I feel that once you become a content creator yourself, you really get to look at like if you're putting out content yourself, you know how to look at a dashboard. You know how to look at those points. Okay, this is why it's working. Or you know, just need to look at this metric, right? In many ways, as tools have opened up for creation, the tools to understand data has just, I think it's almost like brought an entire generation of marketers in, people who can work with brands, etc., who might understand data and how to look at data metrics better than anybody who's like a data specialist is what I've come to believe over time.
Yeah, I think if you just give access to any of these tools to any of the creator, I think the kind of metrics that they would quickly go after looking for, okay, this, let me compare this. Okay, for this, like basically between these months, what happened? And quickly connecting into what happened that month and what actually played out. If there was what news event broke and how that connected to the pieces that you put out. And like, it's just, I think, culmination of events. And when you realize, like a lot of factors played into the success of this basically one piece. And I thought it was all me. Oh, it wasn't all me. It was basically this news cycle broke. This happened. And then I did this. And that is why it happened. Yeah. I think a lot of things just come together using data. But I still realize, like, I still feel like the current set of data tools are not as user-friendly. The only one that I've come across is CrowdTangle, which Facebook has very beautifully acquired it, just taken over, and they've just made it available to brands now.
Yeah.
I think that is one of the best tools out there. Also makes sense why Facebook acquired it, yeah.
Any pieces that you've done in the recent past that, because what I would love to kind of run through is that how you guys, without giving away any secret sauce, how you guys kind of work through any of those ideas and how do those kind of happen?
So I think last year around November, an OTT giant was running a 2-month long campaign about some streaming festival. And now this competitor brand, like we see this happening. Oh, this is happening.
Yeah. It's standard, right? You'll always have that. You'll have that across OTT. You'll have that across colas. You'll have AI. Totally.
Yeah. And we realize this. 1 month passes. The first month is usually competitive brand saying it's not as big. Let's not touch it. The second month when the campaign is now full-fledged, like it's all out, guns blazing. all the top talent, etc., is being used to basically market this phenomenal campaign of basically 2 days, I think, worth of streaming absolutely free. No other brand has ever done that. And rather so, like, you've done doing that and also marketed it to a potential where, of course, the nation is going to tune into and experience this brand now for the first time. So this happens. Now with the competitor brand, the conversation begins. What do we do about this? Do we also, like, and now the windows, like, all the doors open up. Now we have 10 days to event. What do we do now? And you're basically counting down 10 days. The first 3 days, just go in the entire brainstorming process on whether we should be doing this or not. That is the whole being, like, the question being that. And I think what then, 7 days to event, now everybody starts scratching their head. And I think everyone is just waiting for one person to stand up and say, oh, this idea is going to work. And in our favor, let's just go for it. I think that, I think, is the most perfect moment, is what, like, most beautiful moment I see, is when all these heads just sitting in a room and still waiting for that one person to just stand up and say, okay, let's just do it. And when you realize that you are perhaps that person, because when it comes to what works on social and the kind of sentiment it will cheer in, among the social crowd, you are that person. So might as well just stand up and say, okay, let's just go for it. And the moment you say it, the entire table is convinced in a way that let's build the ad first. Let's just put all our monies behind this, building this ad out in the next 3 days. Like, you're going on floor, you're going to be ready with script in like day one, then going on floor on day two. And then day three, you're going to have a final edit in place. That's like this. And then you're left with just 3 more days to event, final event. I go back with a budget. I create this whole thing. In 3.5 days, I put together the film. We shoot it. We get it edited. We, like, casting. Everything is done, like, in span of 3 days. The film is ready in 3.5 days. The final edit of it. And then you go to the brand again, because brand has already spent so much money on this. And the decision to whether to put it out or not is yet to be taken. And then you take it there, and then everybody's watching it. Everyone finds it funny, etc., etc. All of that happens. And again, we come back to the discussions. Oh, now should we just put this out? And, like, and now everybody is just basically sitting again on the table. And again, there needs to be one person who just says, let's put it out. We'll not run ads first. We'll just put it on social, see the sentiment in the first hour of things. Then we put it on all your verticals, like, whatever, wherever you bought ad space, like Facebook, Instagram, that maybe TVC or, like, wherever, like YouTube ads, etc., etc. Then you go all gun blazing out once you see the first the reaction in the first hour. So the kind of comments that you get in the first hour of things would also be a good sample to work with, that that is what the kind of comments that you'll get throughout the next 2 days. So let's just run with this. Again, the same thing. You take a small, like, you run it with, again, a small sample size. What the kind of sentiment it, and then go back with data points. This is great. This 70% positive, whatever, whatever. And then you just go back and say, let's run this across all verticals and just go all done spacing out. And it worked out so beautifully. I think that was, I think, last year. And kind of, again, changed a lot of things for me, in sense that my understanding of how brands work or how brand managers work, I think it's always intuition and gut. Even with data and all of that things, that it, I think it only makes your gut stronger, but I think it like towards the end of it, it's just the trust that it comes with. Had we not been working with this brand for 2 years, this would have never happened. Because then who would you, like, who would they bet on? Someone who has had a consistency over 2 years, and now they're saying, okay, let's do this big thing. I think that is what, I think, changed a lot of things for me. And which is why I think just these long-term relationships with brands, it just, if you have a longer relationship, more beautiful things will just come out of it.
So true. You know, you said a few things which I thought were very interesting, right? Is that one is obviously the standard ones, which are like how agile this whole system was, etc. But the pieces that stick out to me is on, there was trust on one end, because it had to be a fully collaborative effort where at some point, the one side is kind of making, knows the other side knows what they have to do. But I also love the fact that how you've consistently said that, you know, this, looking at the sample size, testing it out. And most times what people don't get about what internet culture has taught us is that the ability to test and see what works and to keep tweaking it. Because I don't think there's anybody creating content today who's not being iterative. You don't make one piece and say, that's my only piece, right? You're saying you're constantly learning from data, from comments, from reactions. That's it almost makes you, A, helps you target, but also helps you push the next piece differently. And that constant evolution, like the same way how you would build, let's say a YouTube channel, you will now build a brand page because, you know, at some point that's how you're connecting and building. I think that part is very interesting, that how you kind of translated that. What is a very core, and I have to stop using the word YouTuber because I think everybody's in the same space now. Considering what the Instagram CEO said about the fact that they're no longer a photo sharing app is literally the statement he's made, right? So I think just translating that to a workflow for a brand, I think makes total sense. And you add in that trust factor, because the trust factor then makes that is required. I think those elements for me actually are great, because if any brand's looking at doing stuff and says, okay, I'm not being able to be agile, or I'm not being able to create in this form, I think that's the trust and just the iterativeness or the testing part, as well as also having someone longstanding who does understand your brand as well. Because I think the problem has been that when you first had agencies come in who people categorize, okay, these are meme agencies, and then they were digital agencies, they were social agency, they were ATL agencies. Well, everybody's an agency now. I don't like that demarcation, but I think everyone thought, okay, we'll get them in for a campaign where thoda buzz ho jayega.
Right.
But I think now it's about saying, if you keep these agencies consistent, and at some point you also learned the tropes of how agencies require those layers and those systems, it makes it better for the brand as well. I feel that conversion is slowly happening.
True. I think brands have now started realizing of the importance of long-standing relationships with agencies and the people working at these agencies. I see that happen now. And I see that happen, like, even with the inquiries that we get in. The cadence of, like, the amount of inquiries that we get for, like, single campaigns, etc., have reduced drastically. But the amount of inquiries now we get for retainer stuff, like, come on, like, solve social for us. That's essentially the brief. Come and solve social for us. And this social means basically everything now. That how do we just basically reach to the people that we want to reach? I think those kind of inquiries have now started coming in, which I find is a much better understanding on the brand front. Like, now they're realizing, okay, this is how we would go about it.
Yeah.
And for us also, okay, whether we want to be involved in a long-standing relationship with a particular brand that is coming in, it makes decision-making for both the parties much more important. Because now you're going in with a committed mindset that, okay, should we be engaged now? It will take up considerable amount of time of my life, their life. If not, let's not do it. And it's that simple now. Otherwise, I think one-off things happen, and usually it leads to more hits. It leads to more misses than hits, and that I've seen. Yeah.
How has this changed the kind of team you have? I know the team's expanded from what was initially the team, and obviously you will have to have people who were there from the start having to adapt to, I would say, more structured system, or rather more agency-like system. But also you'd have new people kind of coming in. And how has that entire process been in terms of the kind of people you looked at, and how has your hiring process and how you kind of bring people in change?
I think hiring process when it comes to creative is still the same, essentially very much still the same. We approach people and we ask them, would they want to work with us? So all the creative departments, I think the content and the design, and usually like that demarcation is also lost now. Like, people in content also design also content, like they also create content.
Yeah.
But the creative hiring is just the same, exactly the same. It's just that, like, now there's like systems in place, so those layers will come in the way before people get hired. So, like, there's just a long, which I sometimes find annoying, but I think that's just the way to go about it. I think that is what our HR would also suggest. No. That's that. This is the process. We'll just follow this process. All of these things need to be taken care of. Earlier, it was not like that. Earlier, I think the hirings were much more simpler for me and much more easier. But now, I still do it the same way. I make a call. I do two calls with people who I know, like who I am genuinely interested in. People whose work I've seen on the internet, etc. I still do those two calls and I just give them my go ahead. Like, I want to work with you. And now, whether the system that I have only created allows you in or not is a separate discussion. But like, I think I would just enter this process and like we should just see if things work out. And that is how it still happens.
We have a bunch more things to discuss. But first, we got to take a small break. So we'll be right back after the break.
Hey, it's been another great week on the IBM Podcast Network. On the Edge is the Sledges Cricket Podcast. In the first half, Ashwin is joined by Varun to wrap India's ODI tour of Sri Lanka. In the second half, DJ joins the party to discuss the first T20 international between India and Sri Lanka. If you'd like to hear more about this match, former Indian cricketer Sobha Kareem joins Rajiv Mishra on Khel Niti and they talk some more about it. Ladies and gentlemen, we're really excited to announce a new show, a show about crypto with Rohan Joshi. He's going to dive deep and demystify all the crypto stuff that we've been hearing about. And let me tell you a little bit more about stuff that's going on the network really quickly. Congratulations to Maru Kinayat, who celebrates 50 episodes of The Note with a discussion on health as a fundamental right. On Paisa Vesa, Anupam talks to Harsha Chetanwala of MyWealthGrow.com. Zarina Poonawalla is starting a new mini-series on emotional intelligence. Do check out the kickoff episode on the Empowering series. And Simplified talks about semiconductors. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any other show for that matter, please do tell a friend. That's really helpful for us. And finally, we would like to thank our sponsors on the network this week. They make this all possible. Thank you very much. Siet, Cred, Global Victoria, Bank of Baroda, Intuit India, Lenovo, and CoinSwitch Kuber. We really appreciate your support.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead. What kind of people, so if you had to say today, if somebody wanted to work in a company like yours, what do you look for? What do you look for in people?
Usually, I think if people have had created anything cool on the internet, stood out even once, like if multiple times in the time frame, like then great. But like if people have done that once or twice, I think that is a good, I start getting good feeling about them getting what works. Everything else is happens later, like whether they'll get the management part, like whether they'll be punctual, whether they'll be this, that, all of that comes in later on. Like that is all the parts that the human resource deal with, the human resource department would deal with.
Yeah.
But I think if that is there, that is primary. I think there's a good chance they'll come in and they'll hit it out of the park, that they'll get it even on the brand front of things, because they get this on what works. I think that is what everybody's trying to solve for, what would actually just click and work with the audience. If they have an understanding of that, that is the entire ball game.
And
it takes years also. Like once you get them in, I think it takes a good amount of time, like for them to give more hits on, like for them to also understand the style of the brand, the ways in which you manage basically the expectations of brand, and how do you navigate those systems again. It takes time, and that's I think different for different people and their abilities and the kind of things that bring to table. But if they get this one thing right, I think everything else is solvable, because that's what was true for me. Like I got this one thing right and then everything else just solved itself. So I think that could be true for everyone, and that is the mindset I operate with.
And how do you approach it for non-creative people when you bring them in? Because obviously that would have kind of grown as well.
Yeah, those are, I think, typical hiring processes for all those roles, all the servicing roles, all the...
But do you look for anything specific in them, that if they don't get it, it's going to become a problem, or they don't get why we work the way we work and why we focus on what we do? And how do you kind of build that into the system?
I think the only thing I rely on that front is recommendations. And getting to know them on what they do otherwise, like outside of, so there are folks who have worked in servicing and there are folks who have worked with brands that they absolutely hated, but like now perhaps they enjoy movies, or maybe they enjoy makeup, or like why have they not just serviced a cosmetic brand or an OTT or whatever. Like, so I think that is one area where it just fits beautifully for servicing folks as well. Just basically understanding like what they otherwise like outside of the job, and if that would just seamlessly integrate into the job, how would that make their life better? And then they start operating also at a much better rate in terms of like churning out, like working with the creative team and like working with the brand. It just brings a lot of things to the table then.
You know, there's always a question I've started to ask is that what are you seeing as pieces that are for the future, right? Like, obviously you had a lot of, I don't think, change in how we consume the internet. I feel that it's literally become our lifeline in recent years. What are you seeing as almost things that are happening which haven't become mainstream yet, which at some level, because you guys look at it in a different lens, that you're noticing, and what would those be?
Interesting. I couldn't think of any. I think what happens is, I think when you're also observing it at a micro lens, it just starts seeming very big in your head. Maybe this is very big. It could be the office memes. I think when you are observing it at a microscopic lens, you realize, oh, Office is the biggest show that in India or something like that, because that is what you're surrounded with. And essentially it's not, even your, like the shows that you perhaps you've never watched are like 10 times bigger than The Office in India. Mm. So I think those things, it's still very uncertain, like what would become mainstream, what would not, what is mainstream in a sense, because everything just travels to such a various degree now. I think it's difficult to keep up on like what's popular and viral across all platforms, or what is viral across just one platform, or maybe just one set of people. It's difficult to keep up with that also now.
I like what you said, because I feel that most times when we look at it, we tend to go very, everybody talks from a macro perspective. And you're saying that if you want to really have that pulse, you're going to be keep constantly looking at it from a micro perspective, and then you got to find something that's happening right now that could totally change, not even tomorrow, like by late night, we're recording in like, let's say what, late afternoon. So late night, it could change a lot. So we don't give micro enough credit. We always talk macro. And I think that's a very interesting way perspective, especially when you look at what the internet is functioning like. You know, everyone talks about broad strokes. Let's go wider. I know I use the word macro too much, but you've given me a thought in terms of, okay, don't focus on micro enough. Maybe there's something there that we all need to look into.
This is, I don't know. This is something I'm myself figuring it out on. Mm. How, what exactly, like when is it that you know that things are viral enough to be called viral? Because there's always a one like, which are easier to estimate are, there's something that travels just across all boards, like across, I would say that would be a Yashraj Mukhate level of sensation, which is across the board viral. You know it's viral.
Yeah.
But just so many other things are also going viral within it. And do you know the level of which that they're going viral or not going viral? Or like, there's just so much else also happening, which I think is very difficult to measure the intensity, like with what, at what level this is going viral. Because I remember once, while still at AIB, Masi had created a template, a meme template, how to talk to short people, which went internationally viral.
Yeah.
Because a couple of other pages lifted it, and it still is it's very much a part of the meme culture, because everyone remembers it. Oh, this happened, and everyone had their own variations and versions of it. Now, if you compare the reach of that template to say a recent sensation would be say Yashraj or something, I think it would just match up when you go with data, you would realize, oh, it matches. There's a kind of reiterations and the repetitions of this one piece that we have seen over on the internet. This is equal. It's the same, but like it's just still two very completely different things. So how, what's like, then what is success and what is viral? I think that it just brings a lot of questions into place.
That makes total sense, to be honest. Because I also have over time, and I think from the beginning, have had an issue with the term viral, because that is something that you can't create a viral. You catch on to something that is viral. Is the way you need to understand it. You can't, like, nothing is original when you're creating it viral.
Yeah.
It is referenced from some point. So they think, oh, let's make something viral. Like, no, you are latching on to something that is viral. Is always the way to look at it. But we still say, I think
which
that
reminds me.
Yeah.
And this I go back to. I have sent this on One Hand Club's group. Like on group, I keep sending this every 6 months.
Hmm.
It's a quote by Nehru when Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay, both of them reached the pinnacle of Mount Everest.
Mm.
And they submitted it. They came back. There was a whole debate that was happening between, like, it became a national issue, an issue about nationalism, on whether one of the two people was Indian or not. And essentially the debate was the first person to reach was Indian, and the people from Nepal were like, no, the first person to reach was from Nepal. And this led to a whole debate, which I think is you would see that happen now also, but it was a similar debate that happened back then. Who was the first one to reach? Was it an Indian or was it from Nepal? That is when Nehru penned the letter down and said that this is shameful. As Indians and as humans at first, what took, like, how Edmund Hillary and Tenzing reached the top is because thousands of others before them tried to reach the top, and they paved way, and they had their own researches, and they made their own, like, they failed so many times for them, for the 1001th attempt by Tenzing and Edmund, like, for to be successful, 1,000 people failed, and they paved way for the success, and that is why they are there where they are. It doesn't matter if they're Indians or not. I think this is just a great feat for it's a great collective human effort why this happened, and all of us should be happy about it.
It makes so much more sense, right? I also find it very interesting that you encapsulated viral internet culture through a quote by Nehru, which I think is just like, which in many ways is actually the internet, right? Is that the internet helps you connect things which you never thought would be connected in that sense. And I think that made total sense. You know, towards the end of every episode, I ask my guests a couple of questions, right? They've always been static, and I'm interested to hear your answers. Also, because I know that you consume a lot of different kinds of pieces. So what do you spend a lot of time consuming that people would not know about, which is tricky because Tanmay seems to show everything that you do in life half the time, if not more, most of the time.
Oh, I've been watching a lot of old Bollywood movies that I never had the chance to watch back then when they released, or have just completely forgotten about. Recently, I watched Satya, which is just out there. Everyone has watched it. I had never watched it.
Oh.
And I watched Satya.
You should actually watch the original one as well. There is this huge, I remember when it came out, everybody from the South would say, no, you have to watch the original. And then I actually like both, but I think it's more preference of just actors more than anything else. But there are some interesting differences which I always thought were good to look at also. Because the version I saw was in Telugu, which was a dubbed version because it was a Tamil film. And then later I saw the Hindi version. So I've actually seen both. I also kind of liked the Tamil version better, to be honest. Because I thought something about Madhavan, which I guess you can't not like in that sense of the word. But yeah, actually, you make a valid point. I should actually rewatch some movies. I always end up going and rewatching Tridev, which is my all-time favorite movie. So that I rewatch more than try to watch movies I haven't seen. I'll rewatch Tridev. I'll rewatch have a few of these, which is my rewatch list.
Yeah. I think the one movie I keep going back to rewatching again and again is Social Network. In fact, all David films are, but Social Network, more importantly so, because there's just so much happening over there. And now when you see what's happening now with, I think the two biggest discussions, the social media giants and the crypto billionaires. And you see like all of them were just kids fooling around here and like creating things off the drum. And now you see like the entire planet's life is like somehow revolving around these things. And these folks have just done it over and over again, like twice in the last 20 years, two decades, two important historical points of importance, like basically. And they have been there at both places, both Zuckerberg and the Winklevoss brothers. So I just keep going back and rewatching Social Network. What just happened there?
I have this weird thing which I've done is that I've actually listened to the entire movie without watching it once, which I think was fabulous. Because I love the soundtrack. And if you actually listen to the entire soundtrack in tune, and then I used to listen to it. I was like, let me just try doing this. And this is pre-podcast day. So weirdly enough, I think I had this habit before. Where I used to listen to entire soundtracks of movies. So I've actually listened to the entire movie of Social Network, not watched it once. And it's just great. It's great, like just the sound design and the narrative there. But it sounds weird when I say it sometimes. But anything you've watched, you've mentioned what you watched, but anything which you let's say read, listened to, or like anything which is more recent that you kind of consumed, which you would recommend?
I don't know. I just feel Sapiens, everyone should just read it once in their life. No matter what pace, no matter how many pages you're reading every day, just start now. Like, no matter what point of life you are at, just read it and then read it again and then read it again.
Makes you feel so small, no? Makes you feel like you're such a small part of whatever's happened. Like, you're not even like not in microscopic is what it makes you feel, but also makes you realize so much.
Yeah.
I agree. What can you put together in an instant?
In an instant?
Yeah.
A tweet? I don't know.
Actually, why hasn't someone said this in a long time? I don't know the last time someone said a tweet. I don't know why people haven't chosen that answer. It's actually a very obvious answer. To kind of seal this one off, why do you think internet culture will not die? Internet driven culture will not die.
I think, again, going back to Sapiens only, and I think they also very beautifully put it, all of human progress has been about networking with one another. Like, humans have just tried to interact with one another. In fact, even from different species, like even when we say Homo erectus and Homo deus, like these were two different species in terms of like, but they were still trying to interact with one another. And from those interactions, we reached Homo sapiens. And now, like, all of us together trying to interact with one another in whatever ways possible. Internet is just a proper upgrade from previous ways of interacting. you can never go back to that. Mm. Internet evolves into something else, and the interaction is much more complex and nuanced. Mm. Is where we are headed, which is a internet 3.0, web 3.0, or 4.0, wherever it takes us. We don't go back. This is, I think, this is the foundation of things, and now more complex interactions with more complex people around the globe. That is where we are headed.
Thanks a ton, Akash. Thanks for doing this. It's been a fabulous chat. I have a ton of pointers, at least for me, and I know the audience is going to have that as well. And I'm happy you finally did this. It's been a long time coming, but it's been a fabulous episode for me to record. And I hope it was fun for you too.
This was a great episode. Thank you. Thank you, Varun. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Akash. Thanks for coming on Advertising is Dead.
If you like this podcast and you want to listen to more podcasts like this, head over to the IBM Podcast website or app or wherever you get your podcast from and look at all the podcasts that IBM makes. There's some really fun stuff there.
A wise man once said, traveling, it makes you speechless, then turns you into a storyteller.
Well, listen to such travel stories and experiences exploring India on the Musafir Stories with us, Saif and Faiza.
Catch us on the IBM website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
உங்களுக்கு தமிழ் கதைகள் கேட்க ரொம்ப பிடிக்குமா? அப்படின்னா கதை பாட்காஸ்ட்ல ஒவ்வொரு திங்கட்கிழமை புதன்கிழமை வெள்ளிக்கிழமைகள்ல வெளியாகிற தமிழ் கிளாசிக்கல் நாவல்களை உங்களுக்கு புரியற தமிழ்ல கேட்டுக்கிட்டே இருங்க. இத IBM பாட்காஸ்ட் ஹோஸ்ட் பண்றாங்க. கேளுங்க கேளுங்க கேட்டுக்கிட்டே இருங்க.